Today, I would like to talk about neuromorphic computing, which means brain-inspired computing in hardware, and give you some overview, talk about a little bit of my work also, but what I would like to emphasize in this talk mainly is that in this field, physics and novel materials are very interesting. And also, please, if something is not clear, just interrupt me anytime. I prefer to discuss with you than finishing my talk. So, as you know, there's been a lot of progress recently in the field of artificial intelligence, and these algorithms, which are neural networks, have made really incredible progress. They can beat humans at some specific tasks, like image recognition, or at complex games like Go or poker. So they have recently done better than the world champion of Go. And they are now commercialized in a wide range of applications. But the thing is that this progress may face some issue because actually these neural networks are running on some hardware that is not optimal for their purpose. You know that they are called neural networks because they are inspired from the brain. So they are constituted of these networks of neurons which are represented with the circles here in this graph, and the arrows are the synapses. But the thing is that today, when they run on a computer, this structure is completely lost. In fact, it's translated into some code, for example, in Python, then it is compiled, so it goes as a series of zeros and ones into a processor that can be a graphical card or novel hardware that has been specifically developed for this purpose by Google, like these TPUs or FPGAs. The development of this new hardware, GPUs, DPUs, have been very important recently to enable running these big neural networks, but still, it's not enough. Here, what I show is some kind of graph that tries to illustrate where all the hardware stands. Let me try to see. Okay, yeah, so here you have the speed of this kind of hardware, of these processors. And here you have their power consumption, okay? And what you see, so here it's everything. So you have GPUs, you have a computer processor, so you have specially dedicated ASICs done with CMOS. You have everything here, and what you see is that it lies basically on this range here. And the point here is that at 100 watts is what we can air cool, and so what you see is that there seems to be some kind of limit, and we cannot really go higher than that. We are stuck with CMOS technology on this trend. And it may seem that it's a lot of huge speed here, but if you put the brain here on this graph, you see that the brain is several orders of magnitude faster than all these hardware, and also consume really very little power, only 20 watts. Okay, and so it means that it means clearly that there is this big gap and that we could do much better than what we do today with this hardware. So why is there this big difference? Well, it's simple. It really comes from the architecture of the processors today. So as you know, in a processor, you have the memory on one side. You have different units that are specially separated. So you have the memory and you have the logic that are two blocks. And if you want to compute, you need to transfer all the time data between, I don't know, maybe there are some chairs here. Yes. So you need to transfer all the time the data between memory and the computing. And this is not usually a big problem, but so usually it's not a big problem, but when we are talking about neural networks, it becomes a huge problem because neural networks are actually like huge fit functions, and they have millions or hundreds of millions of parameters. And when you want to run a neural network or train a neural network, you need all the time to fetch all these parameters in the memory, bring them to the logic part where you do some very complex matrix operations, and then bring back to the memory, and you have to do all the time this data transfer. And this consumes a lot of energy and also is going really slow down the computing, which means that today, real-scale neural network, for example, for image recognition, take like weeks or months to be trained on GPUs. On the contrary, in the brain, everything is completely parallel, and you have this very entangled structure where neurons can be seen as performing the processing, and synapses can be seen as holding the memory for the neurons. And because the synapses are really here in between the neurons, they can give the data to the neuron where it's needed. And so you don't need all this data transfer between memory and processing. They are entangled. And this is why, there are plenty of reasons why the brain is low energy, but this is the main reason of its very low energy. It's this intrication between memory and computing. And so now many people are aware of this and say, okay, instead of trying to bring closer memory and logic in a computer, we need to try to merge the two very intimately, like in the brain. And so why not simply try to fabricate physical neurons, physical synapses, and connect them together a bit like in the brain. So this is what people are trying to do. So, in fact, map this kind of structure on a chip. And the issue, of course, is that we don't know what, in the brain at least, we don't know what neurons and synapses are doing exactly. We don't have the code for the brain. So there are two main trends in the field of neuromorphic computing. Some people are trying to fabricate neurons and synapses that are as close as possible as biology using physics or chemistry or many, many mechanisms. And other people are saying, okay, in fact, if we want to make a useful chip that computes with a low power, why not simply at the beginning look at what is done currently in artificial neural networks and try to give these neurons and synapses the features that are needed in the algorithm. Okay. And so what are these features? They are quite basic in appearance. So in fact, a neural network, so you see it's like that, it's represented like that. So what they are good at is pattern recognition, typically. So and the best algorithms today, they work in a way that is supervised, which means that they are trained with a lot of images that have been labeled by humans. And so you know the outcome for these test images, okay? And so typically what you want to do, you show an image to the network, and this image is going to come from your camera, for example, so it's going to have millions of pixels. And so each, here it's very simplified, but in fact you have millions of pixels at the entrance, and what you want to do is to completely reduce the dimensionality of this input, because what you want to say is what is in the image, for example, a cat or a dog. Okay, and so this is what you want to achieve. If you show a cat here, you would like this neuron, for example, to output a one, and if you show a dog, it will be another neuron that will represent another class of input that is going to output a one. And so how is this achieved? Well, you need two important things. First, you see, the neurons, they are applying a function to their input. And so this function has to be nonlinear. You cannot have the output that is proportional to the input, because what you want to do is basically to guide the information through the network to create some kind of avalanche or chain reaction, so that when you show a cat, you have a chain reaction that leads to this neuron to light up. And with the dog, is this neuron that is going to output to one. So you need this nonlinearity. So, for example, in today's neural network can be a sigmoid or something that is called the rectified linear unit, so there are many possibilities. And then you have the synapses. And so this is where the training is very important, because these synapses, what they are valves for the information. So they are just, so what they do is that they take the output of the previous neurons and they are multiplied by these weights that are then summed and constitute the input of the next neuron. So they are weighted, they are just a weight that can be positive or negative. And so originally, these weights are in fact generally chosen completely randomly. So you show an image and the network is going to respond something that is wrong. You compute the error because you know the result. And then from this error, there is a way to calculate, to correct a little bit for each weight using a rule that is called backpropagation or gradient descent. And by doing that repetitively, you can at some point converge to a network that is going to be able to perform well on the images that have been shown, but also to generalize to other images. But this requires millions of images to work well, so it's very slow. Okay? And so you see, it means that if we want to make hardware neural networks using this principle, we need the neurons to be at least a nonlinear function. And we want these synapses to be these analog weights for the information and to perform this weighted sum. And of course, the weights you see, you want them to be retained, right? They need to be here. They are going to be changed all the time. They need to be very precise, yes.
This nonlinearity is a kind of memory?
This nonlinearity is not a memory. It's just, at least in most artificial neural networks today, it's just a function. The values here are real values, and you apply a function to these values. Okay, so the first question is, can we do that with our current electronics using CMOS? And it may seem the best idea, but actually, as you know, a transistor is nanoscale, but still it's just a switch, and it's not a nonlinear function, and it doesn't have memory. So if you want to emulate neurons and synapses with CMOS, you can, of course, but it's going to take tens of transistors, and for the synapse, you need additional memory. And CMOS silicon memory is super expensive, takes a lot of area, and is very difficult, in fact, to merge with the logic. And so, in the end, a neuron or a synapse that is done in CMOS is going to have lateral dimension of the order of 10 to 100 micrometer. And it may not seem much, but in the brain, there are in fact 100 billion neurons and 10,000 times more synapses. So it's enormous. So if you take these numbers and you say, okay, I just try to put in 2D all these devices to reach this number without taking into account the fact that you need to connect all of them, well, you end up with a chip that would be 300 meter wide. Okay, so we need to shrink these dimensions. And so that's why today there are some demonstrators, some neural networks on chip, some special ASICs that do this kind of chip. But in fact, in the chips, are not, even if they are super expensive and there are billions of transistors on the chips, there are not so many neurons and synapses. And so what they can actually do is quite limited. So, so what does it mean? It means that if the dream is not to make a huge computer that is in fact going to compute, to consume a lot of energy, if we want to make a small chip that is going to be able to run state-of-the-art neural network, for example, for image recognition, so we want to have a small chip like that, 1 centimeter square, where we have 100 millions of neurons and even more synapses. So if you make the calculation, you see it's very easy. It means that each device, each neuron, each synapse should be of with nanoscale dimensions. So this is the first challenge, because it means that we need to invent to create these new novel devices that perform the functions that we want. And the second challenge is that we need to interconnect all these nano devices. So what you are seeing here is the reconstruction of the brain, so a 3D reconstruction of the brain. So it's a part of the retina. So this is a biological brain. And so you see in the brain, there are in average 10,000 synapses per neuron. So it's enormous. It means that you have these 10,000 wires that connect each element together. And you see how the brain achieves that. It does it by using 3D and this very intricate structure. And what you see also is that the camera here is moving in these kinds of holes, which are the blood vessels, which is, means that you need also to bring energy inside of this structure. So it's this number, the number of connection per neuron, seems to be correlated with intelligence, so there are less connectivity in less intelligent animals, so it increases. Humans have this number. So it seems to be important, and so it's really a challenge to achieve that, as you imagine, when we have only electronics that is for now mostly in 2D, and we like to do very regular grids of wires and not these crazy structures. Okay, so these are the two main challenges, doing these novel nano devices and then connect them very very densely together. So what are the solutions? Well, the main trend today is to say, okay, it's okay. There are much less neurons than synapses. So let's make the neurons in CMOS. It doesn't matter if they are a bit larger. And let's really try to shrink the synapse. And so for that, people are using devices which are called memory stores. So in that case, the idea is that the physics you use is that you are going to do an electronic circuit, right? And so the information that is going to flow is the current. We have seen that the synapse is a weight, it's a valve for the information. So what is a valve for a current? Well, it's simply a conductance, a resistor. So a memory store is just a nanoresistor, but which value can be changed in an analog way. Okay, and so typically it has this kind of behavior. This is a resistance as a function of voltage. And what you see in this representation is that you can tune the resistance between different states by changing the voltage. And also what is very important that you see when you tune the resistance and when you bring back the voltage to zero, it's going to keep the value in memory. So it's a valve and it's a memory at the same time, so it can really implement memory close to computing. So how can this be achieved? So of course we want it to be nanoscale, so there are really many, many different ways to do that. A very famous way is to use filamentary switching. So the idea is that you take two metallic electrodes. You have a thin insulator in between, for example, 300 nanometer of insulator. And then what you do is that you apply a voltage. So of course, it's an insulator, so the resistance is infinite. And then you ramp up the voltage. The electric field becomes very, very strong until you create some dielectric breakdown and some. So it can be atoms from the electrodes, metallic atoms that migrate, or you can have oxygen vacancy, depends on the material, etc., that migrate. But what you do at some point is that you are going to create a conductive filament. You're going to create a conductive filament between the two electrodes. And then once you have this bridge between the two electrodes, of course, the resistance drops to some small value. But what is interesting is that then you can tune the voltage that you apply and you can retract the bridge or create it again, and so you can vary the resistance between the different values. So this is one way. Another way, and of course what is very interesting is that if you are careful when you create the filament, you can make it very small. So you can have only a few atoms that are going to touch here. So this can be really nanoscale. You can shrink down to 10 nanometers this device. You can also use some phase change materials like chalcogenides, the ones that are used in a compact disc. Indeed, in these materials, they can go from a crystalline to amorphous phase by applying current pulses. And of course, these two phases have different conductivities. And so you can have mixed phase, so you can have this kind of variation of resistance. In my group with my colleagues in the oxide group at CNRS Thales, we have also investigated other kind of memory stores, because what you see here in that case is that these variations of resistance, they are due to the motion of atoms, due to the voltage that is applied. And so one of the challenge is to have enough cyclability and to have stable device and also understand their physics very well, because it's an intricate, there are some phase change, some heat effects. There are this filamentary switching is very difficult to model this device. So we here with these ferroelectric tunnel junctions, we have tried to propose another mechanism to obtain memory stores where actually you don't rely on atomic motion, but what you do when you apply a voltage that you are going to modify in a non-volatile way the barrier of the junction. And when you modify the barrier of a junction, you can really change the resistance exponentially. So this, we do that with ferroelectric materials. Yeah.
To draw the attention back to the Hopf field type of memory. So the different steps there, so it comes from different kind of updating horizons.
Excuse me.
OK, so the question is, these different steps here, you mean here the different step in the resistance, what do they memorize? OK, so in that case, what if we take, for example, this mechanism, these are going to correspond to different distance of the filament, of the end of the filament to the bottom electrode. And in the case of the phase change device, it would be here you would be completely crystalline, on the other hand completely amorphous, and in the middle you would have mixed crystalline amorphous phase.
You memorize memory and phase, right? You memorize amplitude and phase.
Here, there is not really amplitude. Here you see it's just a conductance, so what you memorize is rather the position of the memory effect from the hysteresis coming from this atomic motion here.
I didn't understand, so you use then strong voltages to fix the resistance, and then you use small voltages to do computations once you have fixed the...
Yes, exactly. So well, first you apply a very large electric field to create the bridge, but you control the compliance of the current while you are careful. Then once the filament is created, you have two different ways of operating. Yes, if you just want to read, you try to apply voltage below the threshold. Like that, you don't change the resistance. And when you want to change the value, yes, you are going to apply, generally what people do is that they apply current short pulses of a few 10 nanoseconds in order to go above the threshold briefly and modify the bridge.
So when you combine all this in a big network, the idea would be to locally control the weights by strong.
Yes.
And then use the network to compute
yes.
with a small
volume. Yes, okay. Exactly. Yes. Okay, and so, so in that way, you see that with this device, we have the valve that we want for the computation, but in addition, for free, we have the weighted sum. This is what is really interesting also, that if you organize the memory stores in this kind of crossbar array geometry, so where here, what you see in red are the top electrodes that allow to lead the current in the device, and in green, you have the bottom electrodes. So at each cross point here, you have a memory store. You see here, if we have this kind of structure, and we connect it to neurons here and neurons here, and that the neurons deliver some voltages, okay? You see that the current that is going to flow here in this green electrode is going to be, because of the laws of electricity, is going to be the weighted sum of these voltages emitted by neurons multiplied by the conductance directly. And so you have your weighted sum, and it may seem very simple, but actually if you want to do this kind of weighted sum with CMOS, it's a very complicated circuit. So this has the potential really to save a lot of area, and this is important when we know that we want a huge number of synapses per neuron. So this is very nice. One of the issues is that these networks are purely resistive, okay? So if you put a voltage here, it's not going to flow necessarily here. It's going to flow, the current is just going to flow everywhere. But this is not what we want. We want to have the weighted sum and to control it. So what people have calculated is that more or less, it's possible to do 100 by 100 memory store structure. But if we want to go larger, we'll have to do many of these crossbar. Or if we want to have a dense arrays, we need to stack them in 3D. And so the idea is that you have your silicon wafer on CMOS. On the CMOS here, you do the neurons, and then you put piles of memory store on top of it, and you find ways, smart ways, to connect all that to the bottom using some vias. Okay. So this is what people are trying to do. For now, there is no chip like that. Okay, people have shown experimentally that you can stack different crossbars and that they work. People are starting to make the first chips with a CMOS silicon and memory stores on top. And I think soon we are going to see some neural networks that are done like that. In the lab, what people have done mostly is that they have fabricated these arrays of memory stores. They have emulated the neurons with standard lab equipment, and they have demonstrated some pattern recognition. So, for example, here by the team of IBM, they have demonstrated handwritten digit recognition with good accuracies. And so these experiments date from a few years, and so now the results have been improved, and they are making these chips, trying to make these chips. And so what is really nice is that it has been, these first experiments have allowed to try to test the efficiency of such chips. And so they, by combining experiments and simulations, they have shown that potentially these neural networks done with memory stores and CMOS neurons can go 100 times faster than GPUs and also consume 100 less energy. So this would be great. And so that's why many, many people are working on this area. Okay, and so, but you see that there are many challenges, of course, is to go beyond these toy models, make a real chip where you have 100 millions of neurons and all these memory stores that work. And so there is a lot of work on the on the lithography, on the design, and also on the algorithm. The thing is that the first chips that are going to we are going to see are only going to do the what is called the inference. That is, the network will be trained on a computer. The weights will be written on the chip, and then the chip will perform something, but it cannot be trained in real time, because if you want to train the chips, you need all this additional circuitry. Then, as you were saying, you need to apply the good voltage to the memory stores, and you need to do that many, many, many times, many cycles, and this is very complicated. Okay? All right. So people are also investigating other possibilities to try to connect all these synapses and neurons, and of course, and recently there's been more and more interesting progress in the field of optics and photonics, because of course, when you want to densely interconnect objects together, light seems to be a very good solution, right? And so I'm not going to go in a lot of details here, but there is a lot of work in this area. The main advantage of optics for computing is also that you can use multiplexing. That is, on a single line, you can transfer a lot of information by using different wavelengths. And so this can be exploited for neuromorphic computing. And so there are many papers that have been published recently. I like this one here, a recent paper in Nature, because they have proposed to do neurons with photonic resonators and to use for the synapse. What they do is that they add some phase change material on top of the optical line, which allows to modify its transmission, so you can weight the transmission of light. And what is nice is that they propose an architecture that is scalable. That is, they really say, okay, you are going to put the input here, it goes through the neurons, and you can combine it, and it's going to go through synapses, and you can make many layers like that. Having this multi-layer, this connection between many layers of neurons, is very important to do these deep networks, which are at the state of the art. So this is one possibility. And actually, in France, there is also a lot of work on optics. There is, of course, the startup Lighton, and there are many groups in Besançon also working, in FemtoST working on this. Okay, and so another way to connect neurons and synapses together, we have seen that you could try to wire them. We have seen that you could try to connect them with light. And what we propose in my lab is try to connect them through radio waves. So our idea is to say, okay, actually, we know that radio frequency communications are a very good way to connect many objects together. We do that with our smartphones, of course. And so we are thinking, why don't we try to make this kind of structure where you have multi-layers of neurons that receive information, process it, then emit the result of their computation and broadcast it to other layers of neurons, and so on and so forth. So this is our idea. And so for this, we need to have this nano radio emitters and receivers. And for that, our idea is to use magnetic nano devices that we've been studying a lot in my lab. So they are called magnetic tunnel junctions. So there are these small cylinders that can be scaled down to 10 nanometers. They are composed of two magnets, two stacked magnets, separated by a thin insulating barrier. And so these devices are usually envisioned to be used as memory bits, because when the magnetizations of the magnets point parallel or anti-parallel, because of the magnetoresistive effects in this device, the resistance is changing from a factor 2 to 3. And so they are the building block for the magnetic memories that are developed by industry today. And so all the major foundries now are introducing these devices in their process. And there would be soon some commercial. So there are some prototypes of chips, gigabit chips with this device. So they can be made in huge number on a chip, and you see that they can be used as memory. So it's interesting for synapses. But here in my talk, I'm going to show you that we can use them in another way. So the idea here is that when you want to use them as a memory, what you want to do is them to keep the information. So the magnetization is always in one direction. But when you want to write the bit, you apply a small pulse of current and you rotate the magnetization, then you cut the current. Okay? But if you send the current for a longer time, so when the current first goes through the first magnet, it's going to get spin polarized. So it's going to acquire some spin. And when it tunnels to the second magnet, it's going to give a spin to the second magnet. And so this magnetization is going to start to precess. And there are some conditions in which the magnetization is just going to precess continuously in a sustained way. And because, again, these are magnetoresistive devices, these magnetization rotations are converted into voltage oscillations that you can measure across the device. And so these are measurements here. So you see the voltage. So of course, the magnetization can oscillate quite fast. So in our case, the device that we use are large. They are 400 nanometers. And the magnetization is rotating at about 300 megahertz. But if you change material or the size, you can also go from gigahertz. So it's very tunable frequency that you can have with this device. Okay, and you see that these oscillations are easy to measure. They are about a few millivolts. And what is nice is that the amplitude of this oscillation is very nonlinear, because when you don't put enough current, the magnetization doesn't move. At some point, it's going to start to rotate. But when you don't put a lot of current, for example, it can have at the beginning a very small rotation. And when you put more spin, well, it's going to increase the oscillation. And so the amplitude of the oscillation depends on the input current here. And so what it means is that you can see them as radio emitters, because they emit microwave. But also, you can use them for computation in a neural network, because if, again, the information is the current, you see that it takes the current, apply some nonlinearity to the current, and then it broadcasts the result. Okay, so it's like a radio neuron. And also what is interesting is that this current that it broadcasts, these electromagnetic waves, so it can be the magnetization, the magnetic field that they emit, or it can be this current that they emit, can be sent to other oscillators. And these oscillators, they are going to receive these inputs, and they are going to modify their oscillation in response to these inputs. And so in that way, they can be seen as radio receivers, because their dynamics is going to be modified by electromagnetic inputs coming from other neurons. And they can even synchronize. Yeah.
Compute what we want it to compute.
Yes. Well. Okay. So. Yes. So is the nonlinearity, the type of nonlinearity, important? Actually, there are some nonlinearities that are used because they are easier for the algorithm to implement the algorithm. For example, people use a lot this rectified linear unit. because it's very easy to make the derivation. So of course, when you have a nano device that does the nonlinearity, we need to use the nonlinearity of this device. You can try to tune it. Here, what I'm showing here, the voltage amplitude as a function of DC current. If I had plotted the volt power, the microwave power, it really is a rectified linear unit. So it's nice for this computation. Okay, and so yes, so these devices, they can compute, apply a nonlinearity, emit their result, and then they can influence other devices that they can change their dynamics, or they can even synchronize oscillators that have different frequencies. And so, so we would like to use them as neurons, but then the question is how to do it exactly. And what we like to do, what we are really interested to do, is to try to take inspiration of the nonlinear dynamics and oscillations in the brain to compute. Because actually, most neural networks today are static. We have seen you have this nonlinear function, but it's static, it's just a function, nothing is moving. But in the brain, it's not like that. Neurons, in fact, act like when a neuron is going to have receive a voltage on its membrane, it's going to emit some spikes and with a given rate. And the rate of the spike depends nonlinearly on the input. And so you can see them as relaxation oscillators. And these spikes, they are really interested to use because, for example, if you have an array here, you have a memory store, and you have neurons that spike, you see that you can hope that these spikes, if they, for example, overlap, can reach large enough values to write the memory store. So you could hope to avoid all the external circuitry that is needed to write the memory store. You could learn directly through the dynamics of these neurons. But also, what is less studied today in neural networks, but I think is very interesting, is the fact that because neurons are nonlinear oscillators, they can interact together through the synapses and they can synchronize. And so it's very well known in neuroscience that massive populations of neurons, even if they are all different at the origin, can all synchronize together. And this is why you can measure signals with EEG outside of the scalp. You are sensitive to these huge oscillations that are detected. And these oscillations, in fact, people are thinking in neuroscience that they are extremely important, in particular to enable the communication between different regions of the brain. Because when you have oscillations are combined to the spikes, when a spike is on top of this oscillation, it can be more efficient to reach another synapse and another region of the brain. Anyway, so in neuroscience, it's very well known that nonlinear dynamics and oscillations are very important for computation and memory in the brain. And what we would like to do with my collaborators is to use also this. We think that if instead of having only static device, we try to give our nano devices these nonlinear dynamics, these oscillations, we could potentially reach, have higher order functionalities, and in a nutshell, do more with smaller neural networks. Yes.
I'm confused. There is a point which I miss.
Yes.
I think that in real brain, the synaptic stress changes with time, according to
your experience. Here, is this synaptic static or dynamic? That means if you have new signals coming in, do they modify or not? That I'm missing this point.
Yes, so the question is to know if the synapses are in this device, are they going to be static or dynamic? Are they going to change over time? So it depends on the device. So for some people, what people are trying in the first step is only to implement what they call the inference. So they would write the device just one time to the good value, and then the network would operate, okay? But of course, what everybody would like to is to have the synapses that evolve dynamically depending on the spiking of the neurons. And so people have shown that with only a few one, two devices. And of course, it's very interesting to try to achieve that in a larger scale, yes. Okay. But so in the last part of my talk, what time it is now, I'm not going to talk very much of synapses. I'm mostly going to show you how we can compute using nonlinear dynamics, oscillation, and our spintronic neurons. Okay, and so it's a collaboration between my group in CNRS Thales in France, the group of Damien Kerlioz in C2SN, and the group of Shinji Yuasa in Japan for the samples. And so what we tried to do, because in the lab we are physicists and we don't have a huge number of devices at the beginning, so what we tried to do is some kind of try to think how can you compute with nonlinear dynamics and try to use for a start just a few nano devices and try to make some toy models experimentally in hardware and try to see what we can do. Okay? And so when you want to do pattern recognition, you have this input data, okay, and you want to, in the end, you want to have different class of data. So you want to separate your input in different classes. And what we did is show that nonlinear dynamics can facilitate this separation of input data in different classes. So we did that using an algorithm that is called reservoir computing. So in reservoir computing, what you have is a neural network like that. This neural network, so you have the circles again as the neurons, and you see that contrarily to the networks that I've shown before where everything was very organized and feed forward, here in this reservoir, the synapses are making loops, some neurons can be connected on themselves. Okay. The idea of reservoir computing is to give some complexity to your reservoir so that you can compute or separate data even without training the synapse inside the reservoir. So how does it work? You have some kind of input that varies in time. So for example, here I take the example of an input that would be successions of sine and square waveforms. Then at time t, you send this input. So for example, this one here, you have some fixed weights. You are going to send this input to some neurons. It goes through the reservoir. And then, so you are going to send your input here. And then what you do is that you are going to have all these very complex dynamics. And so the hope is that for the different inputs, you are going to generate enough crazy response that the response will be very different for the sine and the square. So imagine you want to, what you would like ideally is to differentiate sines from squares. What you hope is to generate enough variety here in this network to really create very different response in the case of the sine and of the square. Okay, but then once you have created all these different response, you want to construct a network output. For example, you would like your network output to be always zero when you have a sine and always one when you have a square. And so for this, to reconstruct this output, you are going to probe some output neurons, and again, you are going to do this weighted sum with some synapse. And the only thing that is going to be trained is this output synapse, so through a simple linear regression. So this is the idea of reservoir computing. You see that normally all the power of neural networks come from training, and here the idea is to say, okay, in fact, if we have this network in the middle which has very complex dynamical response because you have all these loops and etc., well, maybe you can generate enough variety so that you need a minimal training to compute. And so what we thought and what many people think in this field is that in hardware, if your hardware here that is going to implement the reservoir already is dynamical, already nonlinear, then, and if it has some intrinsic memory also, this, you can reduce the number of loops here, then you are going to almost intrinsically generate this complex response thanks to this dynamic. And so in that way, you can facilitate the data separation and obtain what you want. And so what we wanted to show is that we can use spintronic nano oscillators to implement reservoir computing. And so what we did is that the following experiment. So here you have a nano oscillator. So what we do is that we send the DC current through the oscillator. So it's going to generate an oscillation. You see it here in gray. And we also send an input through an arbitrary waveform generator. So here you see the input in pink. All right. And you see the response of the oscillator to the input. And of course, the amplitude of the oscillator is going to vary with the current. But you see that it does not respond immediately to the variations of current. And so this is because the oscillator for a given input current is going to be on a trajectory. Then when the current changes, it's going to go to another trajectory. But in order to go to the new one, it's going to take some time. And so this relaxation time is going to give some memory to the network. I forgot to say something very important. Why we want this memory is because you see the input to the network is these values here, which are presented successively in time. But you see that in the sine and the square, you have some values that are the same. For example, one here, you have the value one in the two waveforms. So how can you know what is the input that has been presented? Well, only if you have some memory of what was before. That's the only thing that, so you need some memory to be able to do the computation. And so here we have this memory for free. And so the thing is that what we did is that we implemented reservoir computing, but we did it with only one nano device. So how can you do a complex neural network with only one nano device? The idea is to use time multiplexing. In fact, the same device is going to play the roles of neurons, of all the different neurons in the network, one after the other. And so in the classical parallel network of reservoir computing, you have your inputs here. What you do is that you multiply your inputs with the weights. So you see here you have a positive weight, another positive weight here, a negative weight. This is then applied to the different neurons in the reservoir. And then at the output, you can measure the response of these neurons and hope to have this variety of response. But then if you have only one neuron, how can you send all these inputs? Well, the idea is to send them one after the other. So you send this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, this one, this one, and so on and so forth. So you reconstruct the input in that way. You send it to the oscillator, and then you measure the output. And the response of the network, you see, you record this on an oscilloscope, and then you can reconstitute the response of this network by probing the waveform one point after the other. Okay, and so this is what we have done. Here, what you see is this pre-processed input. You recognize the sine and the square. And here, what we measure is only the amplitude of the voltage oscillations recorded here. But what is important is that here, this is what I show here is the input one for the sine and the square. And here is what we measure with our oscillator. And you see that because of this intrinsic memory of the oscillator, different outputs have been generated even if the input is identical. And so it means that here, thanks to its nonlinearity and the intrinsic memory, the oscillator has separated the inputs. And then, of course, we want to reconstruct the output. So normally, in the parallel approach, what you do is that you do this weighted sum at the output to reconstruct the network. Here, what we do is that we sample the recorded waveform. We do it in software. We multiply it by weights in software to reconstruct the network output. And so here is what we have obtained. We have sent an input with 80 randomly arranged signs and squares. The target here, the zeros and ones, are in gray. And the reconstructed output from the experimental data is in red. And what you see is that the reconstructed output follows very well the target, and also that there are no errors. In fact, if you draw a line in between, you don't have any crossings, so you have a perfect classification of signs and squares. And so this may seem not so impressive, but actually, this is very difficult to do with a nano device at room temperature. This has been recorded for 1 millisecond. This corresponds to millions of oscillations, and you see that we would not have the noise here is the noise of the experiment, and you see that there is no drift, so the nano device is stable enough, has low enough noise to achieve this result. And so this is very nice. And in fact, we have also made some more complicated tasks. So for example, we have used a database where you have audio files, which are digits from 0 to 9, pronounced by different persons. And so what we have shown is that our oscillator can recognize the digits with a success rate of 99.6%. Which this number, what it means is that the oscillator does as well as much larger neurons in hardware and as well as in software. So it was a kind of validation that we could use these nano devices for neuromorphic computing. Okay, and I think it's late, right? So I'm going to skip the last part. I'm just going to mention the main result. So in this part, what we did is that we showed that with a single nano neuron, using the nonlinear dynamics and the intrinsic memory, we could separate data and do some neuromorphic computation. And so, more recently, we have shown that we could use nonlinear dynamics also, not to separate data now, but to regroup the data within classes. Yes?
Sorry, just one question about the previous one. How much of this time multiplexing do you have to do for recognition?
So the question is how much time multiplexing we need to do for this audio recognition. So for this database, we need 400 neurons. So we need to multiplex 400 times. If we wanted to, this is a very simple task. If we wanted to do a more complex task, we need even more neurons. So my personal opinion is that nano devices, the real interest of nano devices is to try to go to the parallel approach where you don't need to do this time multiplexing. And this is what we want to do in the future. But as a first test, it was a good test for proving that it was working, doing some computation.
Yeah. What's the limit for the time multiplexing?
So there is not really a limit, but if you imagine that you have a network with 1 million neurons, then you will be 1 million times slower than with a parallel approach. So it's really important to be fully parallel. Yes, and so what we did recently is that we have shown that with nonlinear dynamics, you can also separate the data, but you can also group the data in different classes. So the idea, again, is inspired from neuroscience. Where people think that the synchronization between neurons in the brain helps to bind information together. So the idea would be, for example, if you have different inputs, different class of inputs, if you have an input from class one, you are going to synchronize always the same oscillators. And if it's an input from a different class, it's another group of oscillators that is going to be synchronized. And that you can just look at then which oscillators are synchronized to know what is the class, okay? And so what we did is that we have made a small neural network, a two-layer neural network, where the first layer is made with two microwave sources. These are lab equipment. And they emit microwave that they are then applied to the second layer, which is done with four small nano oscillators for device. And then these lab equipment, these microwave sources encode for some spoken vowels. And these vowels are encoded in the frequencies of these microwave sources, and depending on the frequencies that are applied, we are going to generate different synchronization configurations in these oscillators, and this is going to allow us to recognize the data. Okay, so and what we did is that we trained this network, and we showed that in the end it could reach a very good recognition rate of 85%. So, which again is in fact as good and even a bit better than what you can do with a multi-layer perceptron with the same number of parameters. So actually, this is the performance of our small network. Here, this is a recognition on the vowels. Here is a comparison with what you can do with a multi-layer perceptron here. So this classical neural network that can do extremely well on the task when you have a huge number of trained parameters. But when you reduce the network and compare it to our small network of oscillators, you see that, in fact, we do a little bit better. And we believe that we do better than this software algorithm, even with our experiments, because in the classical feed-forward neural network, you see there are never some cooperation in the neuron in a layer. Whereas in our case, the oscillators were coupled together, and so they were kind of voting together to choose what was the correct output. And so it shows again that nonlinear dynamics is interesting for computing. Okay, and so, well, I'm going to end my talk here, but what we want to do in the future is really to try to move to this kind of complex network. So until now, what I showed you is direct communication from neuron to neuron. In the future, we want to add some synapses in between, and we would like to go to a larger neural network. But for that, we need to work. And it's something that is very general in this field. You cannot use really the algorithm as they are. You need to work at the same time on the physics of your device and on the algorithm to make them match and obtain as much as possible from your hardware, given its advantage, for example, nonlinear dynamics or optics or something, but also its disadvantage, which are that they are never perfect. You never have a nano device that is going to be able to encode 32 bits floating points. So you need to find ways to make a neural network function despite these irregularities of your nano device. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for your talk. I have a question. You insisted that the oscillator has some dynamical functionality.
Yes.
But then it seems that you are to sense the time derivative of the signal. But then you are doing this multiplexing, which seems to screw up the timeline. So I was confused. Once you multiplex, then there is no sign. There is no sine or square, right? It's
When you multiplex, yes, in the first part, you mean here?
Here. No, just before or after, I think. Here. When you multiplex your J of T is...
Yes, so I'm not sure what you mean. There is no sign of square, but here is the input that we send, so that is multiplexed. You see, you recognize the sign and square.
Uh-huh. So you still sense the time derivative, it still has a meaning once you have cut your timeline into pieces?
Yes, it's very important that you still have the dependence on the time. Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you for the talk. I was wondering what is the kind of coupling between your layer and what is the decays and of the field decay length of the field. So can you select that you couple to just one layer or will you couple to all the layers?
Yes. Okay.
And how you could you control the synapse? I mean, to which...
Yes.
Or do you control it or not?
Yes, it's a very good question. So for now, we don't have a synapse. So what we do, it looks like that. The two microwave sources, they are connected to a strip line that is 300 nanometer above the oscillator and is about 1 micrometer wide. And this strip line is going to, so it's going to inject the microwave signals here, which is going to generate a magnetic field above the oscillators and modify their dynamics. And so I would say this is a way to confine the signal just above this layer. And it means that if we wanted to send to another layer, we could take the output here that now goes to the spectrum analyzer, but we could amplify it and send it in another microwave line that would go above the other layer. If we want to confine the signal on a layer, we can send it to a strip line. If we want to send to everybody, we could just have an antenna that broadcasts. So there are different possibilities. Sorry? So here, what we don't have crosstalk between the... In fact, we kind of use the crosstalk between the oscillators because we use the synchronization to compute. But I think we could easily avoid the crosstalk between the layers because we can really confine.
So my question is about the part when you use the one nano device many different time delay responses to have like kind of many neurons.
Yes.
It means like you use instead of spatial domain, you use time domain.
Yes.
So my question is, in this framework, would you not have hierarchical connections between your neurons, because each state will be dependent on your previous states, but not won't be dependent on your. So you kind of have some restriction, right, in the neural networks.
You are right. So it's equivalent to this kind of ring. Yes.
What kind of problems it can be applied, or I mean, did you investigate, like, because it's specific type of connection neural network you will have. So how much applicable it's for general problems?
Yes, you're right. So when you do the time multiplexing, you are confined to this. So you can add functionalities, what people do. So because here we have just the device and we use its intrinsic memory, okay? But what you can do also is add some delayed feedback, something we have done, so that allows more connections. So you can play with feedback to add the functionality. But honestly, it's very empirical reservoir computing, so there are no rules to say you need this connectivity to obtain this result. So it's difficult to say how restrictive this is.
Okay.
What is sure is that when you, here we use only the short-term intrinsic memory of the device. So of course, here you cannot make tasks when you need to remember a lot of inputs in the past. So this really requires to have this delayed feedback to have a long-term memory.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. I have two questions. One is, did you do some trials to decide what was the optimal ratio of the number of reservoir versus the trained neurons? And second, is this mechanism used in the brain?
So the first question, yes, we had to adapt each time the number of neurons to the task we were doing. So for example, for the sine square, you need at minimum you need 24 neurons. For the audio digit recognition, you need 400. So it really depends on the complexity of the task. Is it used in the brain? The concept of reservoir computing is inspired from the brain. It was proposed by neuroscientists. Now, is it used in the brain? I have no idea. I think they don't also. I think nobody knows. Yeah.
I think we had a question around. Hi. Right now, what is the main challenge in scaling up the size of the reservoir?
The main challenge, for us, for example, the main challenge it may seem a bit stupid, but since we are physicists, let me show you how. So we are working in these conditions here, so with an electromagnet, classical lab equipment, and a small PCB where we have only a few devices. And if we want to go to something that makes sense, for the parallel approach, for example, imagine we want to do the audio. We need 400 of these devices connected together with the electronics that go with it, and we just are now learning to do that. I think it's...
So there are no physical constraints or limits that you foresee?
I don't know. No, it's more some practical issues that we need to solve before we can...
And one last question, if you don't mind. Do you think there would be any way to implement adaptation? Because that's one of the main features of a logical neuron.
Yes. It's a very good question. So with the device that we have right now, it's not possible. If we want to have, so adaptation is the fact that the rate response of the neuron is going to depend on time. Well, I mean on the inputs, right? So in our case, for example, we would need to add an additional mechanism. For now, the only thing that is acting on the magnetization is this spin torque. But some people have shown that you can also have some gating effects with some dielectric or things like that. And I think the way to go forward is to combine these different effects that can have different time scales to achieve what you say.
Thank you.
Okay, so you started by saying that there is a heat dissipation issue in the classical computation. So what would be the limit here? So you have hysteresis, so you might have also heat dissipation.
Yes.
Combination. So do you have any idea? Because you go quite slow for the time being, not that compact.
Yes.
So will you suffer at some stage from?
Yes. So so ideally, if you can scale down the device to 10 nanometer. Let me show you, it's even better. I have some kind of slide. So, in fact, with all the novel technologies, you know, they switch in a few nanoseconds and they consume this amount of current. Basically, they are all resistive based. And so, typically, this is what you could, on the graph that I showed at the beginning of the speed as a function of power. Depending on the number of cells, so what is written here is that is 1,000 device, 10,000 device. You can expect to make this jump to this line here, and you see that it's going to depend on of the number of device that you can put on the chip. So here, this suppose that you have 10 to the 8 device on the chip.
Thanks for the talk. So you said that you need to adapt the number of resonators to the task. What if you put too many? Does it overfit, or is it like neural networks where you have this implicit self-regularization where you generalize even with very large networks and smaller data sets?
It's a good question. I didn't really think about it because for now we struggle to put many devices. I think if you have too many, so yes, of course, if you have too many, you would overfit, so you need to adapt the number that you use for your task. However, you will always have this noise that I think is going to help to regularize your network intrinsically. So.